In this video, we are going to have triangular form of a linear transmission, which is one of the canonical forms. So first we will have the definition of similar transmissions. Two linear transmissions S and T in A of U are said to be similar if there exists an invertible element C in A of U such that T equals CS C inverse. As A of U is isomorphic to the algebra of all n cross n matrices, the above definition holds for matrices also. That is, we can have S, T and C to be matrices such that T equals CS C inverse implies that those two matrices C, T and S are similar. Well, we have an example. Suppose V is R2 and S and T are defined in this way. Then we can easily prove that these two are similar because we can find an invertible transmission C from V to V defined in this way such that T is C as C inverse. And we can easily find for this transmission C the inverse to be this. So we can prove this by considering the images image of XY, any arbitrary element under this transmission to be equal to this. So if we are able to prove that, then we can have T equal to CSC inverse, and that way we have S and T to be similar transmissions. So now in the next result, we are going to have that similarity is an equivalence relation on A of V. We know that similar two transmissions are similar if T equals CSC inverse. So to prove this, we have to prove reflexivity, symmetry and transitivity. So because so we consider three elements S, T and R in A of A. First, if you consider S to be any element, then S can be written as I, S, I inverse. I is identity transmission. So this says that S is similar to itself. So that proves the reflexivity. Now suppose we have S to be similar to T. That means T equals CSC inverse. Then by pre-multiplying by C inverse and post-multiplying by C, we get this. So which states that T is similar to S. So if S is similar to T, and then T is similar to S means, then we have symmetry also to be true. Now for the transitivity, we will have S to be similar to T and T to be similar to R. Then we have, because S is similar to T, we have this. And for the next one, T similar to R, we have this. Using this T over here, we get this, and from this we conclude that our relation, that is S is similar to R and therefore transitivity holds, and therefore this similarity is an equivalence relation. Now the corresponding equivalence class is called a similarity class, so that helps in defining canonical form. So canonical forms means this, that is, we prove the existence of linear transmission in each similarity class whose matrix in some basis is of a nice form. These matrices are called canonical forms. There are many possible canonical forms, namely triangular form, Jordan form, rational canonical form, but here we consider the triangular form. So transmission basis in some basis gives us a matrix, and that will be in a particular form. General name given to that is canonical form, and in particular we are going to consider the triangular form. So for which we need certain definition like invariant subspace and a lemma based on that will help us in proving the main theorem. So next we have the definition of invariant subspace. If we consider W to be a subspace of a vector space V over F, then W is said to be invariant under T if WT is contained in W. So if we have WT, which is again a subspace only because T is a linear transmission, W is a subspace, this is the image space, so that will also be a subspace of V only. But the thing is, if we have WT to be wholly contained in W, or if it equals W, then we say that W is invariant under T. Now if we consider singleton 0, kernel T and VT, these are all subspaces of V only. They are all invariant subspaces of V. Now on the other hand, if we consider W to be this collection, we can easily prove that this is actually the x-axis. We can have this W to be a subspace of R2, but it is not invariant under this transmission. We don't say that under any transmission it is not invariant. Under this transmission, it is invariant. The reason is, when we consider WT, when we compute this WT, we get that to be this collection, but obviously this is not contained in W, and therefore this W is not invariant under this T. So next lemma we have, if W, which is a subspace of V, is invariant under T, then we are going to have our T to be T inducing a linear transformation on V mod W, which is quotient space. When W is a subspace of V, V mod W, we know that it's also a quotient term, and it's also a vector space called quotient space. So T bar, when it is defined in this way, it takes any element here which is of the form V plus W. If it takes this in this form, then we are going to prove that this T bar is a linear transformation, that is the first subdivision. And then if T satisfies a polynomial, say some Q of X over F, then so does T bar. T bar also satisfies the same polynomial. And if P1 of X is the minimal polynomial for T bar over F, and P of X is the minimal polynomial for T, this is for T bar and this one is for T. So this P1 of X, what is the relation between those two? P1 of X must divide P of X. So these three subdivisions we have to establish in this lemma. So for that, first we will establish that T bar is well defined, T bar is a linear transformation, and Q of X is satisfied by T, means Q of T is 0. We'll have to show that Q of T bar is 0, and the third P1 of X divides P of X. So first we will prove that T bar is well defined. Now for that we consider two elements in the domain to be the same, say V1 plus W to be equal to V2 plus W. Then by this result, which is established already in section 4.2, that if U plus W equals U prime plus W, then U minus U prime should belong to W. So using which we have V1 minus V2 belonging to W. So when we consider the image of this entity, it should be a member of WT very obviously. And WT being W is invariant under T, and therefore WT must be contained in W. So we have this step. And again, make use of the same result, we get this step. So, but this is nothing but the image of V1 plus W and a T bar, and this is image of V2 plus W and a T bar. So we consider the elements in the domain to be the equal, and we have got the images in the codomain to be the same. So we have T bar to be well defined. For to prove that T bar is a linear transformation on V mod W, two conditions are to be checked. One is with regard to addition, the other one with regard to scalar multiplication. So when we consider the sum of these two elements, we have V1 plus W plus V2 plus W of T bar. For this one to work, it should be of this form, some element in V plus W, only then T bar will function. So for that, we use the definition of addition in any quotient space. So we have this step, and by the definition of T bar, we have this step. Because T is a linear transformation, we have this step. And V1T by the definition of T bar is nothing but the image of V1 plus W and T bar. And this is nothing but the image of V2 plus W and T bar. Now, in the same way, when we consider the scalar multiplication, by the definition of scalar multiplication in V mod W, we have this step. And by the definition of T bar, we have this. And because T is a linear transformation, we have this step. And by the definition of T bar, we have this step. So we have this T bar satisfying these two conditions for it to be a linear transformation. So we conclude that T bar is a linear transformation, and this proves the first subdivision. Now for the second subdivision, we have we consider Q of X to be this polynomial such that Q of T is 0. That is, T satisfies this polynomial. We consider this polynomial, and T satisfies that. So that is our assumption. Our job is to show that Q of T bar is 0. That is, T bar satisfies the same polynomial. So for to prove that, see, when we consider Q of T bar, it will be like this only. And in order to have this n, the index for, this is for T bar we have, in order to have it for T power, for T, we need to establish this. T bar power n is same as T power n bar. This conjugate, it is not in the sense of conjugate that we use here. Here already we know that how T bar is defined. So it is not like your complex conjugates, and that is different. Now we consider V plus W T bar square. So composition of mappings that's used here. So first we apply this, we get this, and then the image of this under T bar again. So we have Vt of t plus W, and this is again composition mappings. So t square we have, and by the definition of t bar, this should be t square bar. We started with t bar square, and here we have got t square bar. As the images are equal, the mappings must be equal. So we have t bar square to be t square bar. So that is very much needed here. So that is why this is established, and proceeding in the same way for any general n also, we are able to establish where n is not equal to 0. Now again, for the sum also we need to establish. So for that, what we are trying to prove here is s plus t bar as s bar plus t bar, for which we consider on this image of image of v plus w under s plus t the whole bar. So by the definition of this mapping, we have to have like this, and by the definition of addition in a of v point wise addition, we have vs plus vt plus w, and by the definition of addition in quotient space, we have this step. And this is again, we have one more step in between, that is, this is V plus W of S bar plus V plus W of T bar, and by the definition of addition in A of V bar, we have this. So we have the images to be equal, and therefore the mappings must be equal. So now if we consider Q of T bar, that is, you are replacing X by T bar, you have this step, and because of this you have this step. From here, you are getting this because of this, what is established here. And from here, you get this step because S plus T, the whole bar is S bar plus T bar. So this is nothing but Q of T, the whole bar, but Q of T is 0, that's our assumption, and therefore you get this. 0, the effect of 0 bar and 0 transformation being the same, we can very well write that as just 0. Now we'll prove the third one. So we consider P of x to be the minimal polynomial satisfied by T bar. If P of x is the minimal polynomial for T, then P of T is 0, which implies that P of T bar is 0. So then just now we proved that if T satisfies Q of x, then T bar satisfies the same polynomial. So if T satisfies P of x, T bar should satisfy the same polynomial. So P1 of x is the minimal polynomial for T bar, and P of x is any other polynomial satisfied by T bar. So by this result 6.1.8, which is this, if P of x is minimal polynomial for T and H of x is any other polynomial which T satisfies, then P of x divides H of x. This is proved in section 6.1. So using this result, the third subdivision follows. Now we will prove the main theorem. If T belonging to F has all of its characteristic roots in F, that is the condition we need, then there is a basis of V in which matrix of T is triangular. So this is the condition required for T to have its matrix in the triangular form. So the proof is by induction on dimension of V. If dimension of V is 1, then the theorem is obvious. The reason is, you will have only matrix of T to be of order 1 cross 1, and that is obviously in triangular form. So we'll have the induction hypothesis that we assume the theorem to be true for all vector spaces of dimension n minus 1. Now we'll have to prove the theorem for V, which is of dimension n. Now we are given that T has all of its characteristic roots in F, so we shall take one characteristic root, say it is lambda 1. So let it be a characteristic root of T. So then we can always find one non-zero vector, which is characteristic vector, such that V1T is lambda 1 V1. We will name this as equation 1. Then having got this V1, with the help of V1, we are going to have one collection W, which is the set of all alpha V1, that is linear combination of just V1. Then we claim that this W is a subspace. First it's a subspace of V, then it's invariant under T, and its dimension is 1. Now the last one quickly follows, because it is spanned by only V1, and that V1 is not equal to 0, we have already mentioned. So it's linearly independent, and it is spanned by only one vector, so dimension of W is 1. So that comes automatically. Now we will establish that first this is a subspace. So first 0 belongs to, because scalar times 0, V1 is 0 vector, it's a member, obviously a member of W, therefore W is non-empty, and we consider two elements W1 and W2 in W, they are of this form. So when we consider gamma and W1, the linear combination of W1 and W2 should also be present in W. So the replacing W1 by this and W2 by this, we get this step. And in the definition of vector space, we had V1, V2, V3, V4, four conditions. Using V2, the second axiom, we have this step. And this is again a member of W, therefore W is a subspace of V. Now, to prove that WT is contained in W, we consider an element in WT as this, and this is what we have. And because T is a homomorphism, I mean linear transmission, we have this. This V1T is lambda 1 V1, that's by 1 we have, and we have by V3, again it's a vector space, 4 axioms we have, V1, V2, V3, V4. So V3 is used here. So we have this, and this is another scalar, name it as say some theta. So it is of this form, so definitely it's a member of W. And therefore WT is contained in W. WT is contained in W. Obviously W is spanned by W is spanned by a linearly independent vector V1, therefore dimension of W is 1. So when we consider dimension of V bar means it is V mod W. So dimension of V mod W is dimension of V minus dimension of W. This is already assumed as n, and now that we had dimension of W to be 1, so dimension of V bar is n minus 1. So dimension of V bar is n minus 1 means by induction hypothesis the theorem must be true. But on V bar we have the linear transformation to be T bar. So if we have to make use of the theorem for V bar, T bar should also have all of its characteristic roots in F. So we note that characteristic roots of T bar being roots of minimal polynomial of T bar, they must be roots of minimal polynomial of T. So that is by the previous result that what we have established. So they are nothing but the characteristic roots of T. So all these are already proved from the proved results that we have. Characteristic roots of T bar are roots of minimal polynomial of T bar is from section 6.2. And roots of minimal polynomial of T bar are roots of minimal polynomial of T, that's from the previous lemma, second subdivision, rather third subdivision. And roots of minimal polynomial of T are nothing but the characteristic roots of T. It follows from a result proved in section 6.2. So we have characteristic roots of T bar to be characteristic roots of T, and therefore by induction hypothesis we can find a basis, say V2 bar, V3 bar and so on, Vn bar of V mod W, in which matrix of T bar is triangular. So triangular means we can have correspondingly the matrix of T bar triangular means the transformation we have in this way, that V2 bar T bar is alpha 2 2 V2 bar and so on, Vn bar T bar we have like this. Already remember V1 T is lambda 1 V1, so that we will use later. So now we want to see, this is only with T bar that we have, what we want is for T we need. So we consider this V2 bar T bar alpha 2 2 V2 bar, taking this to the other side, this is what we have. So 0 bar actually means 0 plus W, and this means V2 plus W of T bar alpha 2 2, this is V2, actually V2 plus W. So we have this, so V2 plus W minus alpha 2 2 V2 plus W. So this in turn implies by the definition of addition and quotient space we have this, and we have again we used one result, you know, 6.1.8. Using that result we can rewrite this in this way. So we have V2T minus alpha 22 V2 to be a member of W means it can be it should be written as scalar times V1. So from this what we have is V2T is alpha 21 V1 plus alpha 22 V2. In the same way, same discussion what we had here, V2T is alpha 21 V1, already take this to the right side. So this is what we have, and the same way for V3T also, I mean V3 bar T bar, with that we can have this step and so on. So now we have along with V1 which is lambda 1 we had, so putting them all together we have the matrix of T to be of this form, which is obviously a triangular matrix. Now from this we conclude that matrix of T in V1, V2, etc., Vn is triangular. Now we have to prove that this V1, etc., Vn is a basis. So that means it is enough we prove that they are linearly independent, because dimension of V is already taken as n, and if we are able to have these elements to be just linearly independent, we can have it to be a basis. So for that we consider the linear combination equal to 0 of the identity element in V, and we can rewrite in this way, taking beta 1 V1 to the other side. And whenever we have an element being written as the linear combination of V1, it has to be a member of W. So we have this to be a member of W, and therefore we have to have this plus W to be equal to W. And by the definition of addition and quotient space, we have this step. So we have rewriting this, we have beta 2 V2 bar, and so I'm using scalar multiplication in V mod W. And then rewriting V2 plus W as V2 bar and so on, Vn bar, we have this. And remember that these are all elements in V bar. We just got V2 bar and so on, Vn bar as basis. So we have to have the scalars to be 0. And remember W is the 0 element in V bar. That is why you have the linear combination involving V2 bar and so on, Vn bar as W. The linear combination equated to the 0 element here, being W, we have this. And because they are they form a basis, they are linearly independent. So from I ranging from 2 to n, beta i's should be 0. So using that and this, we get beta 1, V1, 0. But because V1 is non-zero, at the beginning itself we mentioned, so beta 1 has to be 0. So we consider the linear combination equal to 0, and each scalar is 0. And therefore, V1, etc., Vn are linearly independent, and in V of dimension n, and hence is a basis. So we have found out a basis in which matrix of T is triangular, and that concludes the proof of the theorem. That is the main theorem. Now we have an alternate form of this theorem, so that we name as 6.4.8. If the matrix A in Fn has all its characteristic roots in F, then there is a matrix C in Fn that should be an invertible matrix, such that CAC inverse is a triangular matrix. So we shall consider A in Fn to have all of its characteristic roots in F. Then we know that given a linear transformation, given a matrix with that, a linear transformation can be associated. So let that transformation be T. Then T from Fn to Fn, such that the matrix of T in the standard basis is A. So we have got one set of bases, V1, etc., Vn. Now since the characteristic roots of T are characteristic roots of A, we have to have, by the previous theorem, the characteristic roots of T are in F. So by the above theorem, there is a basis of A in which matrix of T is triangular. So we have now got another set of bases. Already standard bases that we have, now some other bases. So V1 etc. Vn there, W1 etc. Wn. So T we have two different bases, two different matrices. Okay, one is we proved in our result in the theorem, second theorem in section 6.3, that if M1 of T is the matrix of T in one basis, M2 of T is the matrix of T in the another basis, then those two matrices are similar. So it is that we are using here. So we have T and A to be similar, which means we can find an invertible C. It follows from that theorem. So we have CA, C inverse. T is triangular already known, established. So CA, C inverse must also be a triangular matrix. Now, with the help of the previous theorem, that we are going to have the last theorem of this section, that if V is an n-dimensional vector space over F, and if T belonging to F has all of its characteristic roots in F, then T satisfies a polynomial of degree n over F. So because T has all of its characteristic roots in F, there is a basis of V in which matrix of T is triangular, which means we'll have V1T equal to lambda 1 V1, V2T equal to alpha 2 1 V1 plus lambda 2 V2, and so on this. Now we will consider this. This implies that V1, the image of V1 and T minus lambda 1 I is 0. So we have just V1, some the image of V1 under linear transformation to be 0. So if you have the operation of, I mean, when you operate on this element, any number of linear transformation, because linear transformations will take 0 vector to 0, we can have this step. We shall name this as t minus lambda 1 I and so on, t minus lambda n I as some s. So t minus lambda 1 I, if we name it as some s, we have just this only, but automatically that gives v1 s to be 0. And in the same way, if we consider this, taking this to the other side, this is what we get. Alpha 2 1 v1 on the right side is retained as such. When you operate on this, this t minus lambda 1 I, we will have V1 T1 T minus lambda 1 I to be 0, T minus lambda 1 I, but that is 0 from here. So any number of linear transformations can be can we can have, so that the image of this under the entire S will be 0. So proceeding like this, even for this we will have V and S to be 0. So V1 etc. Vn being a basis, we have with V1s 0, V2s and so on, Vn is 0. For any vector which is written as the linear combination of basis elements, we have to have the image of V under S also to be 0. And this 0 vector can be written as the image of this any V under 0 transformation. So as the mappings are equal, I mean as the images are equal, the mappings must be equal. So we have S to be 0. S is taken as this, so this must be 0, which means that T satisfies the polynomial x minus lambda 1, x minus lambda 2 and so on, x minus lambda n, and therefore we conclude that T satisfies this nth degree polynomial. So with this, the lecture series comes to an end as for chapter 4 and 6 are concerned. That's for the second semester portion in which have, I mean, in the universities which have prescribed Ian Hurst in topics in algebra as their textbook. Thank you.